Awesome.
Thank you.
So what I want to talk about today is I think we can all agree that media use is growing. But it's an important question, why? Well, the first answer is probably obvious. There are new media all the time. Just in the last week, we've had Samsung announce a watch. Other manufacturers coming in saying, well, we have watches too. We have autonomous cars that will now, by 2020, first announcement, will be driving. All these different technologies are appearing. So sure, that should lead to an increase in media use. There's a second important trend, which is increasingly, media are not just producing one stream of information. They're producing multiple streams. We know that computers have many windows. We know that while we're using our phone, we can surf the web. Tablets allow for more and more functionality. Almost every device now, including a watch, can give us many pieces of information at once. So there's one engine of change, which is a technological change. It's very important, but it's not the only one. There's a second change, which is a change of culture in media use. So let me give you some examples. One of the lovely things to do in France, in California, throughout the world, is to go to the beach. You smell the ocean breeze. You hear the lapping of the waves. You feel the sand on your feet. How could that not but be enhanced by an iPad? Or another example, you go to a wonderful restaurant. Every known culture organizes enormous rituals around food. Food is a time where we rarely eat alone. We eat in groups. We engage. We talk with each other. We see each other in a highly intimate setting. And of course, obviously, we should have a phone in there as well. Okay. Or the third example. One of the great joys every culture knows is children at play. Their laughter, their engagement, their excitement, the raw physicality of children playing together. How could we miss out on that? Well, in fact, there's been a fundamental change. Media have introduced themselves into these activities which seemed extremely intimate and powerful. And that has very important effects. On top of that, there's a third dynamic driving the growth of media use, and not just single media use. And that's the process of partial media displacement. Probably one of the most important and least known theories out of the field of communication. And it's a very simple one at first. It says, what happens when a new information product or service appears? Well, I think you could all guess the first thing that would happen. It would steal time from other information activities. So, movies stole time from books, radio stole time from movies, television stole time from radio, the internet steals time from television, etc. A very obvious process. And if that was the whole story, it wouldn't be a very exciting story. But what makes media so powerful, so exciting, and so seductive is that not only did they steal time from information activities, they also start stealing time from non-information activities. So ever since the middle stages of the Industrial Revolution, we have seen year-over-year growth in media use with blips every time a new medium appears. Media steals time from non-media. However, a third phenomenon has started to happen, which is media started also stealing time from face-to-face communication. So all of a sudden now, not only are we taking time away from our non-human-to-human relationships, media is now moving in and taking time from our human relationships. But you might think there's an answer to that. Here's my day planner. And sure, I'm going to schedule more and more media time, and my day planner may get tighter and tighter and tighter, but there's going to come a moment when I can no longer have media steal time. And at that moment, something big has to happen. That happened around the early 1990s for teenagers, and has increasingly hit other age groups. No more time to steal. At that moment in history, there was an inflection point. And society could have gone one of two directions. One direction it could have gone was to say, that's it. No more time to steal, fair enough. If a new medium comes in, it's going to take time from other media. End of story. It loses. That could have happened, but it didn't happen. Instead, what happened was the use of media in parallel with other activities. We double book media. Just as when we're too busy to fit in, what do? We schedule two meetings at the same time and hope one of them will work out, right? Or three meetings or four. We're doing the same thing with media. We schedule media. We schedule as many as we can. We cram it in and hope it'll work out. And we'll see in a few minutes it doesn't work out so well. In fact, what effectively is happening, we're seeing the horizontalization of media use. Our day planners, instead of stealing vertically, are now stealing horizontally. This is a phenomenon called multitasking. And multitasking is ubiquitous. We see it in all these different domains. And we can ask the question, how ubiquitous is it? Well, the average Stanford student uses three media at the same time, which means for faculty, we know that when they're writing a paper, they're listening to music and watching a cat play the piano or some other activity because they've got to use three media time. And the top 25% of Stanford students are using four or more media at one time whenever they're using media. And it's not just writing papers. When they're consuming entertainment, when they're at the movies, a time that used to be a time to be transported into another world, to be totally immersed and absorbed, they are not immersed and absorbed because they're twittering, they're putting themselves back. They won't immerse into media. It's enormous consequences. There are also, on top of these dynamics, there are corporate policies that dictate multitasking. You increasingly see companies say an email should be answered next minutes. But what does that mean? That means you're checking your email at least every X minutes. We're told to keep our chat windows open so that other team members can reach us at any time and distract us from what we're doing. And of course, our cell phone is not just something we can use for our personal use, it's become our work phone, which means work, time with friends, time with family have all become blurred. Media stealing time from other media. Now, what are the cognitive consequences of that? Well, we can ask the question, does at the moment multitasking impede performance? And if you talk with Stanford students, they will say they do have a superpower, which is using many media at one time. However, sadly, it's a lie. In fact, you're more likely to be able to fly or be invisible than use many media at one time. It turns out the brain just can't do it, at least in respect to media. And in fact, performance is impeded. Everything from the little runner at the bottom of CNN or ESPN or the other channels. Turns out you actually learn less from both what the person speaking is saying and the little runner at the bottom. You just can't do it. But in some sense, it couldn't be any other way because the brain is not built that way. We only have about 3 bits for working memory, and 3 bits isn't a whole heck of a lot to do stuff with. What I want to talk about is actually the more pernicious effect, the least appreciated effect, which is the effect of chronic multitasking. So here, I've lived for the past 7 years in a freshman dorm. I'm a resident fellow at Otero. If any of you from Otero, I'd love to hear from you. And at Otero, I would see the kids multitasking all the time, and I'd say, well, what's going on here? Don't you think there's going to be a problem? And they would tell me things like this. When it really matters, I don't multitask. Or, multitasking doesn't bother me because I do it so often. Or a favorite of every professor who gets older as freshmen stay 18. Young brains are able to multitask, Professor Nass. You, ... can fill in whatever blank you wish. Well, I was jealous of those students and wanted to know whether, in fact, they could really do something I couldn't do and wanted to know their secret to success. So we actually did a number of tests with them, which we'll talk about in our breakout session, but I'll just give you one example. This is a task you would think the average 7-year-old would be able to navigate without difficulty, and certainly a Stanford student. But I'll ask you to do it real quickly. I'm going to show you a group of rectangles twice. I want you to ignore the blue rectangles. All I want you to do is pay attention to the red rectangles. And to make it easy for you, there'll only be 2 red rectangles. And to make it even easier, they're not going to even move their location. All that's going to happen is between the first and second picture, one of the rectangles is going to rotate. And I want to know whether a red rectangle rotated or not. Does that make sense? Couldn't imagine a simpler task. Only 2 red ones, just pay attention. Ignore the blue, it's very easy. Okay? So here's what it would look like. They would see this for 200 milliseconds. Then for 100 milliseconds, they'd see picture 1. Then there'd be a clearing of the retina. And then you would see the second picture. So how many of you thought a red rectangle rotated? Have you thought a red rectangle didn't rotate? Okay, well, it turns out a red rectangle did rotate, and it turns out here's what happens with the students. The students who do not multitask were unfazed by the number of blue rectangles. There were 0, 2, 4, 6, made no difference whatsoever. But the high multitaskers got lost in the world of blue. There were so many distractions and so few things to really worth paying attention to. How could they not but be seduced? Okay. So that has enormous implications, and we'll talk about some of the other effects of that. But just real briefly, multitaskers have many other problems. They can't pay attention, even when they want to. They are actually very poor at managing working memory. They find it very difficult to focus on writing, and they don't even multitask very well. Turns out people who multitask all the time are worse at it than people who never do it. Now you may wonder, what the heck is going on? What is their problem? Well, their problem lies in their brain. This is an fMRI, a functional magnetic resonance imaging scan, of high and low multitaskers doing a task of switching from one task to another. That little white dot in the left prefrontal cortex is what we saw in everyone 20 years ago, and what we see in low multitaskers now. That's a part of the brain used for stopping decision making, etc. Okay? The yellow is what we see among high multitaskers, the extra brain power used by them when they are doing the same task. That actually is the visual cortex. And what's remarkable about this, literally, these people are in a dark metal tube, strapped down, their head braced, where there's nowhere to look other than the screen. Yet, the second they're asked to multitask, they immediately start scanning the environment. And as a result, do much worse in their thinking. So this becomes a very powerful suggestion that chronic multitasking is rewiring the brain of kids and increasingly adults, and has consequences.